Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Last Enforcer. Outrageous stories from the life and times of one of the NBA's fiercest competitors. By Charles Oakley, with Frank Isola. Read by Adam Lazarre-White. To my grandfather, Julius Moss, who believed in hard work and being a man of your word. Foreword by Michael Jordan. It doesn't matter who you are or how confident a person you are. When you're going into a tough situation, it always helps to have some protection, to have someone you can count on by your side, to have your back. For me, in a game of basketball, that was Charles Oakley. He truly was my enforcer. Oak came to the Chicago Bulls as a rookie in 1985 and almost immediately announced his presence. In training camp, you could tell right away that he had what it took to make it in the NBA. I broke my foot 3 games into the season and didn't get to play with Charles much at first. But as I sat on the bench in street clothes, I watched, and I liked what I saw. The league was a lot more physical back then, and Oak was perfectly suited for it. He was a hard worker, smart, competitive, and no matter the situation or who he was up against, he was not going to back down. Simply put, you did not mess with Oak. I knew that when I returned to the court, I'd have a bodyguard. I had become a target for other teams. And Oak wasn't afraid to mix it up with players who came after me, who might have been bigger than him, but definitely weren't tougher. I truly appreciated his willingness to take on that protective role, and we quickly became close friends. For all his grit and physicality, though, Oak was also a great player, far from one-dimensional. He could score, rebound, and pass, in addition to throwing that well-timed elbow or punch when he felt it was necessary. It's no secret that I was not happy when Charles was traded to the Knicks in 1988, because when someone you trust has your back, you don't want that someone playing for your opponent. But I wasn't just going to miss Oak on the court. I was also going to miss seeing and being around my friend every day. The Bulls met the Knicks in the NBA playoffs 5 times between 1989 and 1996, and our rivalry was among the fiercest in league history. Getting past Oak, Patrick Ewing, and the rest of the Knicks was never easy. In 1992, they took us to Game 7 for one of only 2 times during our 2 championship runs. The stakes could not have been higher, and the intensity was off the charts. I knew what we were up against, and knew that Oak, in particular, wasn't going to just lie down for us, friends or not. This was old-school basketball, with each team pushing the other to its limits. Oak and I briefly reunited as teammates on the Washington Wizards during my last season, and I hired Oak as an assistant coach for my then Charlotte Bobcats team in 2010, because I knew our players would benefit from his experience, his competitive nature, and his legendary toughness. Has Oak changed over the years? Well, I'm not sure I would have predicted he'd ever compete on a show like Dancing with the Stars or become such a great cook. The man is a master behind the grill, but believe me, he definitely makes a mess. But Oak is still Oak. He still doesn't back down, and you can't intimidate him. He's uniquely himself. It's been a long time since we shared a basketball court, but if I should find myself in a tough situation, there is no doubt who I would want by my side as my enforcer. 1. Knocking out a jackass. I did not punch Charles Barkley. Do you need me to repeat that? I will if it means people will stop spreading lies about me. Enough is enough. I'm going to set the record straight, because for more than 20 years, that rumor, the one of me allegedly punching Barkley before an important NBA Players Association meeting in 1999, has been told over and over, to the point that it's become something of an urban legend. But the story is false. So for the last time, I did not punch Charles Barkley. I did, however, slap the shit out of him. Barkley had it coming to him. He was talking a lot of shit about me. That's what he does. He talks too much. So I did what I do. Mention my name to Barkley today, and he'll still go the other way. You get hit with a lot of words in the league. You get hit with a lot of elbows, forearms, shoulders, and occasionally fists, too. You don't have to hit first. You just have to make sure you get in the best shot. And I got Barkley pretty good. I was a power forward in the NBA for nearly two decades with the Chicago Bulls, New York Knicks, Toronto Raptors, Washington Wizards, and Houston Rockets. And I had plenty of run-ins over those years. I played in the golden era of physical play, the 1980s and 90s, and combat was part of my job description. According to the record books, I had almost as many rebounds, 12,205, as points, 12,417, which tells you what my role was on every team. That's a lot of work in the paint, and that's where things tend to get nasty. There's one more telling statistic. I rank fourth all time for personal fouls, 4,421, just behind Robert Parrish, Karl Malone, and Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. I'd like to think that most of the fouls were worth it. A lot were used to prevent a dunk or a layup. In New York, Pat Riley got credit for saying we had a no-layup rule. I played by that rule my whole life. In addition to Barkley, I mixed it up with Xavier McDaniel, Rick Mahorn, Bill Laimbeer, Alonzo Mourning, and even Larry Johnson, who later became my teammate with the New York Knicks. When you really think about it, that's not so many fights over the course of 19 seasons. Most of the violence in the 80s and 90s NBA was controlled, and contrary to popular belief, I didn't fight all the time. I fought when I needed to. I fought when it mattered. Was I a physical player? Absolutely. Dirty? No. But if you fucked with me, or one of my teammates, I wasn't going to back down. Never. I've been that way my entire life, and I'll be that way until the day I die. I wasn't the first guy in the NBA who was wired like that, but I might have been the last. Before me, there were bruisers like Maurice Lucas, Lonnie Shelton, and Kermit Washington. A few months after the Portland Trailblazers won their one and only title, Lucas was featured on the cover of Sports Illustrated. It was the magazine's NBA season preview issue, and the photo was of Lucas positioning himself for a rebound by sticking his elbow in the throat of the Seattle Supersonics' Dennis Johnson. The headline was, "The Enforcers." I liked that, Enforcer. That nickname stuck with Lucas, and it made an impression on me. I was the guy who would do all the little things to help my team win, rebound, defend, and be physical. That was my mentality in every game. In one of my final seasons with the Knicks, we played in Portland, and Mo Lucas came into our locker room to talk to me after the game. We had a nice conversation. He said he admired the way that I went about my business. The guy was a legend. He died of bladder cancer in 2010 at the age of 58, 1 year older than I am as I write this. I think about that a lot. I think about a lot of things that happened during my career. I think about getting traded by the Bulls before they won the first of their six NBA championships over eight seasons, or losing to the Houston Rockets in the 1994 NBA Finals after taking a 3-2 series lead with the Knicks. The Knicks traded me prior to the 1998-99 season, and they went back to the NBA Finals that year, though they were beaten by the San Antonio Spurs, who were led by David Robinson and a young Tim Duncan. That Knicks trade wasn't the last time the organization threw me aside. All those years of taking a charge and landing on my back, or jumping into the front row for a loose ball, didn't mean anything 20 years later to the guy then running the franchise. They dragged my ass out of Madison Square Garden. They started that fight, not me. But that's true of all the fights I've had. Someone starts it, I end it. Because I fight like a man. That's the way I was raised. Cleveland, Ohio is my hometown. It's a tough and proud city. I grew up on East 123rd Street and Superior. It was a nice house with a front porch. The neighborhood was mostly black, probably 95% black, and we all looked out for one another. That's just how it was. Right down the street, there was a barbershop where the older guys would shoot dice and play cards. When I was about 10 or 11 years old, I'd clean up the place, and they'd give me money. They'd send me to the store to buy them food. They'd throw me a $20 bill, and I'd keep the change. When I was a few years older, they'd let me roll dice and play cards with them. It was a good hustle when I won. In the neighborhood, you had the barbershop, laundromat, record store, seafood place, food market, and a corner store with a barbecue counter where they made the famous Polish boys. That's a sausage sandwich with kielbasa on a bun. You cover it with French fries, coleslaw, and barbecue sauce. The Polish boy is big in Cleveland. We invented the thing, and this place in my neighborhood had the best barbecue sauce going. I used the money from the barbershop and the dice games to buy food. I never told my mother, Corrine, that I got the money from gambling because I didn't want to get in trouble. I wasn't sneaky. I was smart. My mother wouldn't have been happy about me playing cards with the old guys, but she was okay with me playing cards with her. That was fine. We'd play poker or tonk, a card game that was popular among blues and jazz musicians from the South, going all the way back to the 1930s. You can play with either two or four players. So me and my mom would play a lot. My mom was good. She talked a lot of smack when she played, but she kept it together. She never drank or smoked. That wasn't her thing. She worked in a bar for 15 years and never drank. My mom still lives in Cleveland, and we're still very close. I'm there all the time. I didn't know my dad much. My father, Charles Oakley II, came from a big family. He was one of 10 kids, and when I was growing up, they owned 5 gas stations in Cleveland. He was always working. He lived with his brothers, while my siblings and I lived with our mother. I seen him, but I didn't see him a lot, you know what I mean? Then he died of a heart attack in 1971. He was only 35, and I was 9. It's just one of those things. I grew up the youngest of 6 children, with 1 brother, Curtis, 11 years older than me, and 4 sisters. Saraline, 7 years older, Carolyn, 5 years older, Diane, 3 years older, and Yvonne, who is 12 years older than me. But Yvonne lived in York, Alabama, with our grandparents on our mom's side. I'm sure you've never heard of York. It's in Sumter County, close to Mississippi. It's about a 2-hour drive northwest to Birmingham, and about a 5-hour drive to Atlanta. I can make it in 4. According to the local records, the town was established in the early 1830s. It was a farming and cotton town, and during the Civil War, the railroad passed through York on its way to a military hospital in Meridian, Mississippi. After World War II, the train traffic slowed down, and people started to move out. It's a mostly black town, and yet the first African-American mayor wasn't elected until 1996. Progress, like life in general, moves slowly in York.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.